Hi, and welcome back to Pay Attention, ADHD Through the Lifespan. I'm Dr. Rostain, Professor of Psychiatry and Pediatrics at the Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania. And this is week 5, where we'll be talking about the neurochemistry of ADHD. So let's begin by looking at the neurotransmitter systems of the brain. In general, there are two categories of neurotransmitters, those that are derived from monoamines, and that includes serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine, acetylcholine, and histamine. And then there are those neurotransmitters that come from amino acids, glutamate, GABA or GABA-aminobutyric acid, aspartate, and glycine. Now, how do these different neurotransmitters work in the brain? What are their roles? Well, first of all, the brain has over 100 billion neurons and many transmitter systems and subsystems. The glutamate system has over 20 billion neurons, and the GABA system has over 8 billion neurons. The norepinephrine and serotonin and dopamine neurons are actually many fewer of those. There are only about 30 to 50,000 norepinephrine neurons and about 250,000 serotonin and dopamine neurons. So it turns out that the billion cell systems, the glutamate and GABA cells, they're the ones doing the work of the brain. And the thousand cell systems are really fine-tuning these billion cell systems. So when we think about serotonin, when we think about the catecholamines, norepinephrine, and dopamine, and when we think about histamine, we have to remember that these systems are actually working on the glutamate and GABA cells. They're the fine-tuning, if you will, of the entire system. Now, looking at the chemical structure of the monoamines that we'll be talking about, especially norepinephrine and dopamine, you'll notice that these two structures in particular look a lot alike. And there's a reason for that. It's because they are actually very closely related in the chemical pathways. So looking at the catecholamine synthesis process, let's begin by turning to tyrosine, which is probably the most common source of neurotransmitters in the body. If tyrosine is not available, the body will make these neurotransmitters from phenylalanine as well. But tyrosine is the most common precursor to our neurotransmitters that we're discussing. Through a process of oxidation and decarboxylation, you end up with dopamine. If you notice, there's been a few changes in the chemical moieties, and from dopamine, when you remove hydroxylase, you turn that molecule into norepinephrine. So these are the ways in which our dopamine and norepinephrine transmitters are made. What do these transmitters really do in the brain? Well, there's an overlap of these functions, okay? So there's really, it's hard to separate them out. But in general, norepinephrine is involved with alertness. Dopamine is involved with attention and pleasure and reward and motivation. And serotonin may modulate anxiety and mood and obsessions and a lot of our appetites. Notice that all of them are involved in mood regulation as well. When we look at catecholamines and brain activity, it's important to keep in mind that these different pathways originate deep in the brain, and these transmitters are neural tracts that go from deep in the brain to all of the different parts of the brain that we've been talking about that are important in ADHD. For example, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the visual cortex, these are innervated by neurons that originate, that tracks that originate deeper in the brain. From the ventral tegmental area and the substantia nigra come dopamine pathways, which I will be describing a little bit later. From the locus coeruleus come pathways that are rich in norepinephrine. And from the nucleus basalis come acetylcholine fibers, again, distributed widely across the brain. Now, what are the neurochemical deficits we see in ADHD? Well, for one thing, we see dopamine dysregulation. For another, we see norepinephrine dysregulation. The evidence for this comes from drug studies. For example, we know that stimulants increase dopamine, and methylphenidate and amphetamines change the rate at which neurotransmitters are either released or taken up. Another medication, atomoxetine, works on the norepinephrine system. So from drug studies, we know that dopamine and norepinephrine regulation can be affected in ADHD and can be helped by medications that address that dysregulation. As we talked about earlier, molecular genetics is also important in getting us to think about dopamine and norepinephrine regulators, because the genes that have been most likely linked to ADHD are involved in these two transmitters. And finally, when we look at neurotransmitters in the brain regions associated with ADHD, these are brain regions very rich in dopamine and very rich in norepinephrine. You may recognize this slide from a few weeks back, and I'm returning to it only to point out once again that the dopamine system and the norepinephrine cells that originate deep in the brain have important functional linkages to the areas of the brain that we've been talking about, the anterior cingulate and the prefrontal cortex, as well as the posterior parietal cortex. And that these transmitters then regulate the activity of all of the other cells in the brain. So dopamine is a key transmitter, we've already said. What are some of its functions? Well, dopamine helps control movement. It modulates reward systems. It keeps us motivated. It allows us to pay attention. It's involved in the experience of pain or pleasure. And dopamine is also involved in emotions. And as I said before, dopamine modulates neural circuits in the cortex and the basal ganglia. And these circuits that are listed here have been introduced earlier in our neuroanatomy lectures, but these are dopamine-rich circuits. The dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, the orbital frontal cortex, the anterior cingulate cortex, the insular cortex, the limbic system, and the nucleus accumbens. All of these are very much affected by dopamine activity. When we look at what dopamine does in general to these key pathways in ADHD, we see that dopamine enhances signal conduction and improves attention. It allows us to focus, it allows us to maintain on-task behavior, and it allows us to think and stay thinking about a particular task that we are interested in solving. So once again, the dopaminergic system is involved in attention. Let's turn now to the actual way in which dopamine is functioning at the level of the synapse. This is a diagram of a neuronal synapse. There's the presynaptic terminal and the postsynaptic terminal. And what you can see in the presynaptic terminal is that tyrosine is converted to L-DOPA, and then from L-DOPA, dopamine is created. What happens to the dopamine? The dopamine is stored in a vesicle. It stays there until a signal comes along. When a signal comes along and there's a need for the transmitter to be released, the vesicle moves to the membrane and releases the dopamine into the synaptic space, where it is crosses the space and it sends the signal across through the receptor to the next neuron. This is the basic principle of neurotransmission. Dopamine is synthesized, dopamine is stored, dopamine is released, and then once it's released, it activates the postsynaptic receptor so that the signal can be sent down further down the next neuron. Now, you will notice that there are MAO inhibitors located in the presynaptic terminal. These break down the dopamine when it needs to be broken down and made again. Okay? There are also other enzymes called COMT inhibitors, and the COMT also is involved. COMT, which stands for catechol-O-methyltransferase. Can I start this whole segment of transporter one more time? All right, I'm going to start this slide over again. You tell me when. So let's review briefly dopamine neurotransmission. This is a diagram illustrating a dopamine neuron, and it's looking at a presynaptic terminal, and another neuron where the receptor is visualized in this diagram. A signal coming down this neuron triggers the release of dopamine into the synaptic pathway. And wait a minute, I skipped the whole, I don't even know what I'm doing today. Hold on, one more time, apologize. I skipped the whole how it's made, right? Okay. Oh. And one, two, three. So let's look briefly at how dopamine neurotransmission works. As I outlined before, tyrosine gets converted to L-DOPA and then also then gets transformed into dopamine, which is stored in presynaptic vesicles. This is the presynaptic terminal of a neuron. Now that dopamine sometimes gets broken down by MAO inhibitors and then it gets recycled and more dopamine is made. So there's a continuous recycling of the dopamine supply itself. When a signal comes down the neuron, dopamine is released into the synapse, crosses the synapse, and begins to send the signal across the receptor. So the receptor is there to receive the dopamine. Once the dopamine interacts with the receptor, the signal is sent down the nerve path, the other neuron. At the receptor side, we have enzymes called catecholamine O-methyltransferase, enzymes that break down the dopamine in the receptor side. Once dopamine is released, it is taken back up into the neuron and repackaged. So there is a recycling going on in the neuron that allows dopamine that's made to be released and taken back up. And it is at this dopamine transporter site that many of our medications work. So there's dopamine clearance is regulated by these three major systems. First, there's the dopamine transporter protein, which is responsible for the reuptake of dopamine from the synapse. There's the monoamine oxidase system, which breaks down the dopamine. And there's the catechol-O-methyltransferase, or COMT, system that breaks down dopamine as well. Turns out, of course, as I mentioned before, the genetic studies of ADHD have looked at genes that code for these different systems, for the transporters, for the monoamine oxidase, and for this COMT transferase. Now, looking at how medications work, it turns out that PET imaging studies have identified that methylphenidate changes the amount of dopamine in certain extracellular spaces, in particular in the basal ganglia. And what it looks like happens with stimulants like methylphenidate is that there's an amplification of the dopamine signal. Now, it turns out, though, that the effects of these medications are context dependent. So what really is happening is that dopamine enhances task-specific neuronal signaling and decreases the noise. So what happens is that methylphenidate may work by improving attention through decreasing distractibility, or maybe making tasks that are otherwise boring more interesting. We'll talk a lot more about how medications work later on in the course, but I think it's important to discuss this now, to point out that it's precisely the dopamine system that is modulated by most of the medications that we use to treat ADHD. So let's turn to the other major neurotransmitter, norepinephrine. Norepinephrine acts on postsynaptic alpha-2 receptors, of which there are three subtypes, A, B, and C. Most of the alpha-2 receptors are postsynaptic to norepinephrine cells. So for example, the dendritic spines of the prefrontal cortex pyramidal cells have many of these receptors. The most important subtype is the A subtype. We think that this is responsible for the way the prefrontal cortex can be modulated by norepinephrine. So norepinephrine signals are important in enhancing the network connections of the prefrontal cortex, largely through alpha-2A receptor stimulation. So norepinephrine, which originates in the locus coeruleus and has connections all throughout the brain, in particular in the frontal cortex, helps to dampen the noise, enhance the executive operations, and increase the inhibitory functions of the frontal lobe. It allows us to look before we leap, to think before we act. So this is where we think norepinephrine plays a role in ADHD. Looking again at norepinephrine neurotransmission, which resembles that of dopamine transmission, you can see that in the presynaptic terminal, tyrosine is changed into DOPA, and then into dopamine, and finally into norepinephrine, which is stored in the vesicle. The norepinephrine, when the signal comes along, is released into the synapse, and from there travels across the synapse to the receptors at the postsynaptic terminal. Now, after the signals are completed, there is a reuptake process that's mediated by the norepinephrine transporter. Once the norepinephrine is taken back into the cell, it might be broken down by MAO, or it might just be repackaged into the vesicle to be released again with the next signal. Note also that in the postsynaptic terminal, there are catechol-O-methyltransferase enzymes that can also break down the norepinephrine. So this is an elegant system for maintaining a balanced amount of norepinephrine, and we believe that in individuals with ADHD, both the norepinephrine system and the dopamine system are not regulated properly. It's not that these transmitters are absent, it's just that they're not being regulated properly. Let's try to put all this together, and I'm going to summarize what you've heard so far. First of all, there is the synthesis and the metabolism of all of the neurotransmitters that I've described, and there are many modulators, by the way, in how these function, but as we mentioned before, dopamine beta-hydroxylase and catechol-O-methyltransferase and monoamine oxidase, they're all involved in the synthesis and the metabolism of these two major neurotransmitter systems, norepinephrine and dopamine. They all interface with the workhorses, glutamate, GABA, and NMDA and AMPA, which we haven't discussed, but which are also amino acid derived neurotransmitters. So what happens then? Let's begin with the brain getting sensory input from the outside world. Where does that sensory input go? It goes to the posterior parietal cortex eventually, which is where we assemble all of the different signals from sights and sounds and other sensory modalities into a picture of what's going on. That's largely the posterior parietal cortex is heavily enriched with norepinephrine transporters, the alpha-2A type. As we discussed before, there's a very rich connection between this part of the brain and the prefrontal cortex, which is rich in different dopamine and norepinephrine transporters and dopamine receptors. This connects back to the striatum, or the movement areas of the brain, the basal ganglia, again, dopamine transporters and D2 receptors, which again then are linked also between the cerebellum and the prefrontal cortex, where D3 and D4 receptors in the cerebellum are activated through these pathways. So you can see how this begins to get into a complex circuitry, which then all of which depend on the proper functioning of both the dopamine in blue and the locus coeruleus in red centers deeper in the brain. These centers then enhance the signal, in the case of norepinephrine, enhances the relevant signals of the parietal cortex. In other words, it allows the parietal cortex to do its job better. And also, norepinephrine allows the prefrontal cortex to work better, not only by enhancing relevant signal, but by also modulating and regulating dopamine. And finally, dopamine suppresses the irrelevant signals and allows us to focus on what's important. So this is a way of diagramming all of the complicated interactions between these different brain centers and the neurochemical pathways that are involved in signaling and transmitting information between all of them. Let me turn now to a summary of the neurobiology of ADHD that we've been discussing for the first several weeks of this course. We can start by looking at ADHD symptoms, as we discussed in week one. There are combined ADHD individuals, or those that are predominantly inattentive, or those that are predominantly hyperactive and impulsive. These are the symptoms. Where do the symptoms arise from? Well, the symptoms arise from differences in basic processes of the brain. And we've talked about executive function and motivation. Under executive function, we can talk about working memory or behavioral inhibition, and these are topics that I will be discussing next week. We also can talk about motivation and the difficulty with either postponing reward, which is called delay aversion, or by being reinforced by whatever is going on and that we're engaged in. So these basic processes themselves may explain the symptoms of ADHD. But what gives rise to these changes in these processes? Well, these are the neural mechanisms belowhand, which we've been talking about. The prefrontal cortex, which is involved in both executive function and motivation, the basal ganglia, and the cerebellum. These are the key brain structures. And what allows those brain structures to work properly are the neurotransmitters we've been discussing. In this diagram, it says noradrenaline. That's the same as norepinephrine. Dopamine also. Serotonin we have not discussed, but this is also perhaps a modulator of the brain functioning we're discussing. We've been focusing mostly on norepinephrine and dopamine. And certainly last but not least, at the most basic level, we can talk about the genes that may be altered in individuals with ADHD. All of these are the gene variations that I discussed when we talked about the genetics of ADHD, and it's changes in these genes structures that lead to changes in the way in which the norepinephrine or dopamine system is working. So we've got now multiple levels to understand, from genes to neural mechanisms to basic processes to the symptoms themselves. One day we'll know a lot more about how all of this works, but for now, this is a summary of what we've learned so far. So let's turn now to a summary of the developmental pathophysiology of ADHD that's been suggested by Dr. Steve Ferrone and colleagues from Harvard. In this model, we want to understand how is it that people with ADHD go through life and what leads to either better or worse outcomes. Starting with the genetic predisposition, we saw that early environmental insults like maternal smoking and obstetric complications can make it more likely that the individual becomes an ADHD child. And ADHD is a frontal subcortical catecholamine dysfunction disorder. I know that sounds like a mouthful, but that's really what we're talking about. We're talking about brain circuits that are not working properly, in part because the neurotransmitters themselves are not being regulated properly. So we can see ADHD in children, but some of them remit. Some of them get better. For them, after a period of time, they seem to be indistinguishable from children without ADHD. So this would be the group that we'd say remits. But there are others for whom ADHD does not go away and, in fact, may get worse. Okay, and in these individuals, we could talk about late environmental insults, such as substance abuse or social adversity, trouble in school. That leads to further brain dysfunction and comorbidities and chronic dysfunction. So these individuals are at much higher risk than for needing intervention. Finally, if the ADHD remains untreated or unresponsive to efforts, and we see then secondary effects like low self-esteem and school failure and social disability, we then see the disorder in adults. What Dr. Ferrone is suggesting is that from a genetic predisposition and both early and later environmental insults, individuals can be left with residual effects that will affect their entire life beyond. And so adult ADHD then becomes the final outcome of childhood ADHD. And we will be talking more in detail next time about the psychology of ADHD, how it affects thinking and how it affects performance in a variety of important tasks. Look forward to seeing you next week. Take care.